Hi everybody, thank you for joining in. I'm just waiting for Samir and Shilpa to join us and we will start soon. Thank you all. Hi.
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 Hi, Danielle.
So nice to see you guys huddled up together.
It's a small screen, so we typically use.
It's nice.
After
I'm
some time,
really
we'll be
glad
pushing
that
each other
actually
out.
speaking to two people today, because we've mostly had like cigarettes. It's nice to have. I mean, it's great. Thank you. So thank you,
Yeah.
Samir and Shilpa, for being here with us today. You guys don't need an introduction, but I'm just going to take the liberty to introduce you to everybody here. We are
Thank
here to
you.
talk about how stone is an integral part of interior living spaces, and we're really glad that you'll be sharing your expertise and insights with us. Quick background: founded in 2010, Studio Osmosis is a multidisciplinary design practice formed by Samir Bilwali and Shilpa Jain Bilwali. The studio's foundation is based on the genesis of the osmosis phenomenon, where the ultimate design is a product of client collaboration and intricate aesthetic details. The firm has, to its credit, many award-winning designs and clients. You've been working on varied project architecture and interior projects as well, ranging from hospitality, commercial, residential, retail, healthcare, across India and internationally too. Studio Osmosis has been felicitated as one of the Hot 100 practices in India in 2017. We've been winning a lot of awards. So thank you for being here with us and sharing these insights. We have a quick format, 4 to 5 questions, and one last closing statement from you on Let's Talk Design, which is the series itself. And if there are any questions from the audience, then we'll be addressing those too. So
Sure.
I will
Great.
actually
Looking
leave it to you
forward.
guys. Sorry.
I said looking forward to the talk, yeah.
Great. So tell us, I mean, you do a lot of commercial projects, right? Hospitality, healthcare, institutional as well. And these are all high traffic projects. So what, according to you, does one need to consider when they're picking out stone for these high traffic areas?
So when we look at all these commercial projects, there are two elements to picking out the stone. One is where your wear and tear is high, and one which is just purely for aesthetic purposes. So that could be wall claddings or feature walls or anything of that sort. But especially when we choose material for high traffic areas, we look for non-porous or least porous material. With a hardy substance on the top, something like a granite. Sometimes when a project is really, on a budget or even not on a budget necessarily, but you have some really nice vitrified tiles, which are composite tiles or vitrified tiles, which actually would do very well. But at the same time, we prefer using the natural stone because it has its own little charm. And it has its own strength that we can really work around with in terms of doing different textures on it, so that we can increase the anti-slip quality of the tile or the marble of it, or the stone of it by nature.
For places like these, you also have to look at the longevity and the maintenance costs, and how often are how often is the client ready to maintain that particular flooring. So depending on restaurants and conversations that we have with them, typically somebody like a restaurant will want a little bit low maintenance. High-end malls are still okay because they do look at a much bigger maintenance sort of package. So you sort of have to look at the entire story also. Who the client is, what the brand is all about, and also what you're really trying to aesthetically show. No, if the character is gonna come out as something that is a little bit maybe rustic or a little that's tropical, then maybe even something like a kota or a you know, like a local natural stone can also work. And if it is something that's got to have a really high end sort of look, a luxurious sort of a feel, then a really nice hardy marble would be something that, you know, we would recommend. Maybe either it could be inlaid or it could be just as you know, seamless jointed flooring. So it will depend on all of it, like the functionality, the space usage, and the number of, you know, people using it.
Right.
Okay. You know, the Osmosis design philosophy is a lot about reflection of luxury with comfort, right? So while picking up flooring for, you know, residential projects, which are, and even malls sometimes, and restaurants, you know, they all actually talk about the same ideology of luxury with comfort. What are the qualities? I mean, what qualities, and plus if you could share some samples of, you know, stones that one should look for. You know, stones that represent luxury plus are easy to maintain and comfortable to sort of use.
I think, you know, one of the topmost, when you talk about luxury, of course, it will depend again on what's the client's idea of luxury here and how we are sort of stating that luxury. Because, you know, today I can say that you can do luxury that's really out there in your face and gives you that first, you know, big sort of look. And then you also have a lot of understated luxury. So based on what direction that design or the project is going to take, you know, you could recommend some really good marbles, which are like high end and actually have a great character with veins. So we do love marbles which have, you know, stronger veins, not something that's very flat. Character is very, very important, you know, when it comes to the luxurious spaces. So when sometimes clients say, you know, what about, you know, these plain marbles or like an Australian white, I think personally, we don't really love it or recommend it too much, because then it starts to look like a tile anyway. So then why go in for a marble, you know, go with the character, the innate character of that particular stone.
Right.
Even if you're using something as a wall cladding, I think even if the budget is not very high, but if you take up one wall which has this beautiful marble or a granite, even with textures that you can add or overlay, you know, you can really give that luxurious statement while keeping the budget and sort of keeping one focus area, you know, so you don't have to do it on every wall. It could be a simple floor and a beautiful wall that becomes a statement. You know, like you go to a lobby and you actually see this first piece over there. So your stone or your marble could actually become a piece of art.
Absolutely.
Which is very interesting because, you know, the function can keep changing depending on the space and the project.
Okay. So you spoke about playing with patterns and textures, right? And we've seen that you play a lot with patterns in especially in like the hospitality projects or even residential projects for that matter.
Right.
So can you give us some advice, I mean, give our audience also, share some tips on patterns and textures?
I think we just lost you in the last part.
Okay. So I'm saying, can you share some advice on how to play with patterns and textures with stone?
Right. So I think what is important is how much of the flooring is really going to be seen. You know, how we tackle flooring is basically the flooring is the first point of your, you know, when you enter a house or let's say a foyer space or a waiting area, or let's say it could be a temple area which has got a certain significance to it. So these are some of the spaces where a patterned flooring or a texture or something like that really works when you are focusing on the entrance impact, or, you know, that's the first space that someone comes in and you really want to make the person feel larger than life, or, you know, that grandeur of it should be in your face. Then when you go into a particular room, or let's say a living room, we like to keep it a little more simple, because then it's you want anyone who's sitting in the room or the guests or the person who's staying inside the space, their eyes should not keep moving into multiple spaces, but it should be more calm, but at the same time, it's either the focus is on either one wall, which could be like a nice bookmatch marble, or let's say we work with a nice water jet cutting, like a tree of life kind of an effect on a stone, which that signifies or that becomes like a piece of art. So then the focus from the floor shifts to the wall, which becomes like almost an inlet turn or something like that, because that becomes your main effect. Then you go to the bedrooms again, or let's say bathrooms is something again you can play with geometric patterns, mm-hmm. or
detailed
again, because it's a tighter space and you want people to focus, or you know, the focus to go on to other areas, you know, like the flooring pattern or like a nice wall pattern along the, you know, you take the theme of there is raindrops falling and you actually create a complete pattern along the shower area. So that is how it complements the use of the space. So how we look at stone or creating patterns in stone is very specific to where the person comes, whether you want the person to stop or you just want the person to continue walking. So it's almost like creating a pause in the movement of a user or a visitor. So yeah. If it's a commercial space, then again, where it's a high traffic area or where the person can sit and see the space is where you'd want to use a lot of patterns or thing which could be appreciated. But you know, where you have tables and chairs, underneath the tables and chairs, where it's not going to be visible, those are the spaces which can be kept clean. It's not in your face.
And then there are other tricks, you know, like when you're in a public space or you're in a maybe a hospital or maybe a education space or, you know, any of these public areas, you also can use patterns to define wayfinding.
Right.
You know, there are subtle ways to make people understand where you want them to go. And flooring is a very interesting way in doing that. In fact, for that matter, even in restaurants, you know, you can create certain, if it's a large space, you can create certain zones with patterns to kind of define the zone without creating physical partitions.
Right.
So it becomes a very smart way of planning and functionality, yet sort of using your patterns in the flooring, you know, in a very subtle way, lighting it beautifully, lighting it where you want the eye to sort of go. So they're very interesting tricks and ways you can use the pattern. Sometimes there are clients who say, you know, we don't like carpets or we are allergic to carpets. And, you know, you want to define that living space like a carpet sometimes. So you can actually use your flooring stone, like your marble, to create a beautiful carpet pattern defined if you know that, you know, in a bungalow space or something like their carpet area. And that sort of becomes a separate carpet zone without physically putting a carpet because, you know, maybe the client didn't want it.
Yes.
And so there are very interesting ways in doing it. Say if you're keeping your floor plain, but you're actually using the patterns in your furniture. So you could also use your marble or granite or the other stones in creating very interesting pieces of inlay in the furniture itself.
Like dining tabletops.
Yeah, like tabletops or center tables or just corner tables or consoles. You know, detailing becomes very, very important. So we really like to use stone in that sort of an interesting detailed manner and sort of working their entire holistic view. But then if you're doing that, then you want to keep the flooring a little bit simpler.
Right.
I think it's interesting how you've actually carried the conversation from flooring, which is the most traditional way of using stone, to corner tables, right? Which really sort of, you know, changes the whole narrative as well. I mean, and that...
Yeah.
And when, because that is where you can start playing around with textures, patterns, you know, a lot more. So this is very interesting. Moving on from the interiors to the outside, you know, stone also can be used for facades, right? And you can play around even there. So what has your experience been like? And what do you think are 2-3 things that one should keep in mind if they're looking at, you know, horizontal and vertical surfaces?
So again, we worked on a mall project in Udaipur, and in Udaipur you have some amazing artisans who work with stone. So we've learned that, you know, to a certain height, to up to, let's say, 10 to 12 feet, it's easy to do stone and carving on stone, which is wet application, which is directly applied on the wall using plaster. But as you go higher, it is better to do dry cladding. So you know, there is, you have that leeway for thermal expansion. So, and also the rainwater sort of comes from behind. So it just works really beautifully. But again, as you go higher, you need some material that is more, it's more less porous in nature, that will not stain due to climatic conditions or the environmental pollution that we have. So something like a granite is what we used over there. But I'm sure we have a lot of other materials that can substitute for that.
For example, if you're doing bungalows or homes in the coastal region along Maharashtra, and you have a lot of the red chira that is actually locally available, and it's beautiful to use. It actually wears amazingly with time, and probably with every monsoon it actually becomes a little bit stronger. So I think the tip would be, wherever you're working, find out first probably the most local available stones, because if you realize, most of the local homes will already be using those stones in their construction, so there are very interesting techniques that you can then try. And of course, otherwise, if you're going to use anything over and above like a luxurious sort of level, then I think the limitations are endless. I mean, you can just do a lot more in terms of textures and patterns.
We've also, spoken about how stone can be used in combination with other materials, right? And a lot of people say that stone is a complementary material. It works with whether it's metal or wood or, how is your, have you tried playing with stone like that? Do you think it works? Do you agree, first of all, with the statement that stone is a complementary material? And if yes, then, what are some of the innovations that you'd like to share with us?
I think stone, I wouldn't say it's a complementary material, but I think stone is a very easy medium to work with, if you're especially trying to do merging with different materials. What we realized is, when you have with the technology that we have right now, and with the kind of water jet cutting materials or the machines that you have, you can really create some intricate carving on the stone and then merge it with a thin layer of wood and then lacquer the whole thing, which gives a completely different dimension to the piece of stone. And and that is something that can really be done. You can even create patterns and mix resin with stone. You can
metal.
Do glass with stone, and you can have a complete lacquer finish on it. And a material or a substance that was viewed only as one earlier has completely changed now, where you can actually do so much more with one particular material in terms of inlaying it or in a mosaic pattern. We can do marble chips with wood chips and then lay it and then lacquer it, or you can do marble with glass chips. You can also inlay, cut marble in thin pieces or have grooves made and inlay brass putties inside. So when you're adding these, there is a specific type of marble that you use, so that you are enhancing the beauty of the marble. You will not take a 4,000 or 5,000 rupees per square feet satvario and then try to do something like this, It's a marble has a beauty of its own, or a stone has its own beauty. You can enhance it by doing, merging it with different materials for a different need.
Also,
whether it is the feature wall or anything.
Also, I think the whole character, other than just saying complementing, you can actually create wonderful contrast.
Yeah.
Because, the coolness of certain material and the warmth of other materials when combined together sometimes can give you a great balance. So if I take a marble, even in a fine dine restaurant, if say, the clients want marble tabletops, and, they have that little cooler feeling, but if I combine that with a warm wooden paneling on a wall, or even fabrics for that matter, that balance is beautiful when you're merging that, like the coolness with the warmth or the softness, or even when you're doing it with, say, just textures. So I think you can really create that balance between the two, in terms of even the mood or the temperature of that space, basically.
Right. My last question actually to you would be, you know, taking this point as well, that, you know, a lot of studio osmosis ideology talks about, you know, a balance between youth and experience, creativity and practicality, right? Do you think stone as a material can play a role in bringing out the functional aspects as well as the creative aspects of what you do at your practice?
Yeah, definitely. First of all, I think we're always going to remain young. So that's why the youth. But on a more serious note, I think for us as a design studio, as a practice, you know, whenever we are conceptualizing any space, you know, whatever genre it is or whatever type, proportion or scale it is, the balance of functionality, materials, textures, as well as the entire intent that, you know, we are trying to create with the client becomes a very important aspect of the entire storytelling. Mm-hmm. So it becomes very important what material you're going to choose, because that will then decide your entire intent of the space. So even very early on in the project conception, it's very important as to whatever your visuals are or whatever your thought process is related to that specific material. So it becomes very important as to, you know, if it's going to be a granite or a kota or a marble, you know, whichever, or even vitrified tiles for that matter, you know, that is going to decide your entire look and feel and your story for that project. So it becomes very important as to how you balance this entire function, practicality, as well as the design aesthetic. And then you have to sort of lead the client into that direction. You know, it doesn't happen that 3 months down the line, I just say, oh, you know, the marble was there, but now the budget's not there, so let's just change this to a vitrified tile. Because then your entire story is really lost. So that becomes very important to
talk. To hear that, actually, because I think even I personally, as an architect, I believe that it's the narrative of the project that actually should take precedence over everything else. And as creative professionals, it's our responsibility that we do justice to that narrative. You know, that's
exactly.
That's what our job is. So, yeah, thank you
yeah.
for right. my thoughts. So would you like to say something as well, Sameer, on how you've sort of integrated this within the practice?
I think she said it all.
Okay, great. So I have a few questions already from the audience. So I'm going to take those first before our closing comment. There are a lot of people who really appreciated the... I have a lot of thumbs ups here. So it's taking me a while
Thank you.
To scroll through. Somebody asked... One second... Yeah, somebody said that, you know, space dividers and highlighters, you spoke about that. When you use onyx, what is a good quantity to use, perfect quantity to use?
Less is more, I feel.
I think onyx is a very, you know, how if I put it in a way, if I would not want it to be quoted and if I would still say it, that you can, it's a love-hate relationship with onyx. You can either go absolutely right with it or you can go absolutely wrong with it. In onyx is a material where when you see it and when you envision a space, it also depends on whether you want to backlight it or you don't want to backlight it. But if it is used in smaller quantities in the right spaces, it looks wonderful. When you go, you know, you find the right onyx at the right price and you go, oh, wow. मेरे को इतने में मिल रहा है सब ले लेता हूँ एंड देन वेन यू ट्राई टू यूज इट देन इट कम्प्लीटली रुइंस द एंटायर लुक ऑफ इट सो लाइक शिल्पा सेड लेस इज मोर आई थिंक वेन यू यूज ऑनिक्स इन अ वेरी सटल मैनर वेदर इट्स टू हाईलाइट सर्टन एरियाज टू बैकलाइट इट एंड और इवन एज एन इनले इन इन मार्बल इन सर्टन एरियाज इट लुक्स अमेजिंग
या
I think that's absolutely true. Another question we have is, how do you incorporate sustainability in high-end interior design spaces?
Well, I think it's all to do with materials and the choice of materials. We always believe in, at least for all the projects and whatever we use, we try to promote sustainable materials. So sustainability is the is a process. It is not... you know, the materials that you use are sustainable, whether it is plywood, whether it's wood, whether it's a veneer, which is from an FSC certified area. even stone. So stone by nature is not sustainable because it cannot be grown. It's a naturally depleting product. But when you say, if I apply the logic of sustainability that, oh, you know what, I'm using naturally sourced stone from my neighboring, that is still sustainable because I'm still not importing it from Italy, or I'm not using a lot of fuel, or there's a lot of consciousness. So locally sourced material could then be the, you know, if I'm be the cause. So if I'm in doing a project in Hyderabad, I could use some amazing granites which are locally sourced from Hyderabad. So instead of going saying no, I want an Udaipur green, which is coming from Udaipur. So I think the sustainability aspect also implies, doesn't mean that you cannot do luxurious project. You can really do some amazing stuff. I think most projects, or in our case, is the byproduct is the waste that we generate, which goes into landfill. I think that is something that, if you can minimize that, would be a lot more sustainable, which is a big challenge for our industry in any case.
Also, I feel, and that's just my opinion, it's a very narrow view, but I feel that the very fact that you've used stone, right? Stone is a material that lasts much longer. So your chances of, you know, changing it often, you know, as compared to a plywood or whatever, are far lesser. So you automatically, by using something that is classic, that is going to last you forever, you are at least adding that 1% more sustainability factor to it. You are going to be sustainable. Perfect, you're not going to keep changing things.
Yeah, so longevity is definitely an important aspect.
One last question here.
Can't hear you.
Is a stone plus resin, is that something sustainable?
No.
Sorry. Can you hear me now? Is this better?
Yeah.
So stone plus resin, is that sustainable?
So resin as a material is not sustainable because it is so once it's hardened, it becomes very difficult for it to turn into a liquid state again and
reuse it. I mean, it's very hard to reuse
it's a
it
chemical also. Product you get chemical products, and there are natural resins as well, but we are talking about the chemical ones. But it is difficult. So resin and stone as a combination, or resin as a material itself, is not a sustainable material. But hence, it's not used in a larger proportion. It's a very small proportion is where it is used.
Yeah, like we wouldn't, you know, recommend that you use resin products in very large quantities. But as a highlighter somewhere, or, you know, we've done small tables with a combination of, you know, resin art and those kind of things. So I think a little bit of that is definitely okay. And I mean, I wouldn't, you know, the fact that we are in the construction industry itself, by default, you are not really in the most sustainable of business. So the idea is that if you can use, good design sense, if you can plan well, if you can use the right, ventilation, sunlight, you know, whatever resources that are available to you, if you can use them well, then half of your job is done well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Totally.
You take little steps to make the whole process more sustainable.
Correct.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. I think we don't have any more questions, but we have one more thing to ask of you. We are following the hashtag Let's Talk Design. So what are your thoughts on that? If you can share a single statement on Let's Talk Design, and that would be very interesting.
When we are talking design, I think it is very important to talk about design and keep the dialogue always open because that is where you learn from. You know, I think learning from mistakes and learning from your processes is very important. And we always like to keep the dialogue open within the community with our contractors and laborers and learn from them, because I think every step there is something new that you sort of learn from your experience. There's no project. I wouldn't say that 10 years back when we started our own firm, the mistake that we made then, we've corrected that. But there is a new mistake that is yet to happen, which we will learn from. And I think that is the dialogue that, you know, keeps us going, learning from others and learning from within ourselves.
Yeah. And I think, you know, the current scenario that we are in, you know, the hashtag Let's Talk Design becomes very important. Collaboration is the key today. You know, there's so much happening out there right now, not just in our industry, but in different industries. And it's very easy to also cross industry collaborate, not just collaboration with designers,
right.
But, you know, whether it's textiles, whether it's fashion, whether it's, you know, craft and art and, you know, so many other things actually do cross-industry collaboration that, you know, the more we discuss this and the more we sort of talk about it, newer ideas are going to breed.
Absolutely. And this series itself is, you know, for that. And, you know, the whole idea is that we all sort of learn from each other. And I think the very fact that we decide to voice our ideas out, right? It helps us improve our process too. Sorry, there's one more question from the audience. Can you tell us a substitute for MDF Duco?
For
MDF
Duco. For MDF Duco. You can use a polyurethane PU paint, which is thinner than Duco and is faster in application than a Duco paint. We use that more often than Duco.
Okay, thank you so much, Sameer and Shilpa. It's been an absolute pleasure to have you with us. You know, as a celebration of A class this year, we are, you know, because you have also spent time with us, we planted a tree on your behalf. So
that's lovely.
From A class, yes, that there
were ideas,
sustainable engagement going. So thank you so much. And it was absolutely a pleasure to speak to you.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for having us. And that's a really lovely initiative. That's a very nice thing to do.
Thanks.
Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Thanks. Bye. Bye.